So recently I covered Anthropic's computer use, and that's pretty cool about how it can basically have an agent that surfs the web, does tasks for you. So what if you want to do that yourself, if you want to build an open source version of that? Well, one of the challenges of that is actually getting some kind of model that is actually going to be able to look at the computer interface and work out exactly what's going on there. And this is what Microsoft's been working on directly with their new OmniParser. They've released a paper and a model that we can use for a variety of different tasks. So OmniParser is all about creating screenshots so that a VLM can basically understand what's going on the screen and then make a decision about what it wants to click on, what it wants to use, what fields it wants to fill out, that kind of thing. So while Anthropic's computer use model looked pretty cool when it came out, they're certainly not the only ones that have been working on this kind of problem. Even Google has released a paper and a data set called Screen AI, which is doing the same kind of thing. Unfortunately, Google didn't make their models available like Microsoft has done now with OmniParser. So OmniParser was originally released as a paper a while back, but Microsoft now has gone ahead and actually released the model. And I think this is a common thing that we're starting to see with the big tech companies, is that when a third party releases a product like something, then they all tend to release some of their research around that to perhaps show that they've also been working on the same kind of thing, or to negate any advantage that third party provider gets, etc. So what can OmniParser do? Well, OmniParser works with both computer interfaces, whether that's Windows, whether that's Mac, but also even mobile interfaces here. And what it basically does is works out everything that's on the screen and then basically labels it and creates labels that can then be used by a large language model or a vision language model going forward. So if you look at the first example here, we've basically got an iPhone style interface here, where there are a number of icons on there. You've got the time at the top of the screen. And you can see that the output that's come from this is basically a set of lists that include things like text box. You can see each text box has an ID there, and icon boxes. And we can see what do these icons actually do, whether it's a weather app, whether it's a note-taking app, etc. Now, that same concept can also be done for full screen desktop apps or laptop apps here. So you can see here, we've basically got it going through labeling each of the different icon boxes, each of the different text boxes of what they are. And this would help the LLM or the VLM to be able to work out which box it needs to press into and which buttons it needs to press to take actions that it wants to take, etc. And as you can see here, they've also focused a lot on web interfaces. So this is going to be key for any kind of agent that wants to surf the web or use the web to take actions, etc. So you can see here, they've got a variety of different things, whether it's travel sites, whether it's stock photography sites, etc. And you can imagine that all these concepts are things that are going to help the model to be able to decide where to run a search and which boxes to click and what buttons to click after it's put some text in there, etc. And interestingly, they used a number of different data sets to be able to actually do this. So first off, what they do is they basically look for regions of interest or interactable region detection. And they're doing this with a YOLO model to basically do object detection and find different things in there. The data set for doing that was basically 67,000 unique screenshot images. And they even mentioned that a lot of those come from popular web URLs, etc. So there's a good chance that a lot of the sort of biggest websites will have been featured multiple times in there, allowing the model to basically learn to find those things and allowing agents then to be able to interact with those things. On top of the just general screenshots that were in there, they also had a second data set, which was icon descriptions stuff. Here, they basically fine-tuned a VLM to be able to describe certain icons. So whether that's going to be an icon for a mobile app, knowing that it's a weather app versus a note-taking app, whether that's probably going to be things like an icon on a button to know that, okay, this is the illustration icon there, to know that this is a file upload icon over here, etc. And the key thing here is that each of these descriptions that the model was fine-tuned to do focuses on functionality rather than appearance. So traditionally, VLMs are often trained more to describe the appearance of what they're seeing. Here, it's much more focused on, okay, what would that be used for? So the OmniParser solution that Microsoft has released really does a number of cool things. First, it's trained to spot anything that's clickable on the screen, just like our eyes are. We've been conditioned over time to know that certain UI does certain things, that kind of thing. Secondly, it can actually understand what each button or icon means. More like I mentioned before, not just the appearance of it, but what's the actual functionality of it as well. And the cool thing is that because it's been trained on such a wide data set, this actually works on Windows, on Mac, on mobile phones, you name it, it's out there. So the overall process is like a three-step process, right? It scans the screen and draws bounding boxes around anything that you might want to click on there. The second step is that it describes what each element does in plain English. Then step three is that it can feed this information to a language model. And now in the paper, they use GPT-4V, but you could also imagine that you could feed this to a variety of different models that are out there. So what are actually the results that they get out of this? So the thing that they found was that this improved GPT-4V's accuracy by over 50% on some tasks, and that it really helped the LLM / VLM to be able to work out what it needed to do and where that was on the actual screen there. As you can see, they've released the model up on Hugging Face. So let's jump into the code and have a play with it, how it actually works. Okay, so Microsoft has released the code up on GitHub and they've released the models up on Hugging Face. So using this, we can basically get started and have a play with how it's actually going. So we just clone in the Git repo. Not a lot major here. So the majority of the code is just downloading the weights, etc. So we've got a set of weights for the object detection models, etc. And then we've got weights for both Florence and Blip2. Now, these ones you can see here are basically the YOLO weights that we're bringing in there. They're using the Ultralytics package for YOLO, which makes it very easy to use. One of the issues with doing this in Colab is that the flash attention is causing issues in Colab at the moment. Rather than use the Florence 2 model, we're using the Blip2 model that they used in the paper. It does seem that after the paper was done, they retrained the descriptor that was originally the Blip2 version to a Florence 2 version. Unfortunately, that seems to need flash attention to actually get it to work, etc. All right, so then basically you just need to go through and do some object detection on things and then run the description model. So you can see here is an example of doing the object detection where it's basically finding and putting bounding boxes around these regions of interest, these interactable regions as they call them. And you can see that it does that right across the entire screenshot. And then after that, it will then basically output these descriptions of these text boxes that are there, etc. So here's an example that I uploaded of a picture from Airbnb. You can see it's done a pretty good job at working out all the interactable parts that come out of this. And then it's got descriptions of all the different things that are in there. So not only has it been able to extract out and find the bounding boxes, etc., but we can see here we've got the content list that we can describe each of these. And we've then got the coordinates for each of these. So if we were to pass those in to a language model, it can basically give us back exactly what to click where, that kind of thing. So let's have just a quick test of that to see what's the quality of these that have come out. Okay, so the first one I tested, I basically just put the image in and the descriptions of the labels in there. And I asked it basically, look at the image and the description, tell me which box I should click if I want to book this property. Sure enough, it basically comes back and says that you should press the reserve button, which is text box ID 21, which if we look at it, sure enough, the text box ID is 21 in there. Claude can clearly do this. Even GPT-4o, this is using GPT-4o in here, giving it the exact same question, the exact same thing. Again, it can also basically work out that it should be text box ID 21 in here. So clearly getting this information and giving it to the large language model helps the large language model to be able to clarify what it should be clicking on, what it should respond to, etc. So as always, I've put the CoLab notebook in the description. You can have a play with it yourself, try it out. You could imagine that these descriptions should work with open source VLMs to a certain extent as well in here. I'm really interested to hear from people, what is the thing that you would use this for various agents? This is the thing that I'm curious to see. What is the sort of straightaway use this to basically process something that would make a very useful agent out of the box? So if you've got any really cool ideas, please put them in the comments below. I'd love to hear what people are trying to do and stuff like that. I may actually try making a little agent or something that uses this to actually do stuff. We could actually take this and put it in a microservice so that you just ping it when you need it, kind of thing. Anyway, as always, if you found the video useful and you'd like to see more videos like this, please click like and subscribe so you get alerted when they come out. Thank you for watching to the end, and I will talk to you in the next video. Bye for now.